chilling for a bunch of times, or, you know, we're fighting, bashing one another in the head extremely often. And both Blitzcrank and Soraka had the sense or the peace of mind to know that they need to be there. They need to push up. If the fight continues, they can help turn the tide. Unfortunately, the fight was over by the time they got there. But great game sense and great awareness from both sides to be in that area at the same time.
Yeah, that was great. Nibia did come out worse for the wear in the sense that her egg is down for a little while, so that opens up gank potentials on her in middle quite a bit.
And compare the farm as well. Currently sitting on 45 CS to 72 on Lulu. But of course, Liumi did have the Doran's Ring very, very early on, which meant he could use those Glitter Lancers to farm up in lane. It allowed him to put a little bit more damage down. And I think it's slightly easier to farm with Lulu at the lower levels than
Anivia
anyway.
Oh, absolutely. It's really hard to farm as Anivia. Her auto attack is kind of unusual. If you don't play her all the time, it's hard to pick up those kills or those, you know, creep scores with those auto attacks. And you generally see Anivia, you know, post 6 with a blue buff. She's not going to miss any more CS, so she'll probably catch up. That being said, Lulu doesn't really miss too many CS post 6 either. Oh, bottom looks like... Oh, okay, that is what Awesome Fusion should have done at level 1. Avoids the pull by flashing away. Was a necessary flash as Lee Sin was going to come in there and be dangerous as well. But yeah, we're probably not going to see Anivia Yamada Potato miss any more CS. It is 59 to 81, so down a little bit, but I think they will make a comeback just by virtue of, you know, essentially free farming with their ultimate.
And the way that Anivia is able to farm with blue buff in that Glacial Storm. Glacial Storm, one Flash Frost, and that's effectively a wave cleared out. Now, Liumi does have 5 points into Glitter Lance, also has blue buff and a triple Doran's. And look at that as well, Akage's lucky pick. We do have Bresh down on the bottom, a great Rocky Gap into a fantastic Wild Growth. As Dr. Mundo was flying through the air, he hadn't even landed on the ground before Lee Sin was, you know, had the Wild Growth, cost 3 mana in Magic the Gathering if you play it at all, and that popped him up into the air.
No, that was huge, because they get the Oracle off of Mundo, so that's another 400 gold that's not reflected on the screen. That's one thing that's rarely taken into consideration. You know, they're an extra 400 gold down because they spent 400 gold on that Oracle and essentially did nothing with it. And they lose the dragon because, of course, they had no jungler presence there. So really good job by Lulu in middle, using her whimsy on herself to speed up, get to that fight a lot quicker than Anivia could.
Have a look at the farm at the moment. You know, we've got the bottom lane, Grave sitting on 95, Urgot 93. That's dead even. Mid lane, Lulu's got a small advantage. In the top lane, Jax has got an advantage as well. Renekton 59 CS to Jax on 82.
Now, that is huge.
It's a pretty decent amount. I've been keeping an eye on the battles as well every now and again. And Swigalex just is toying with Baron Panda every single time they jump into the fight and commit to some damage. Baron Panda always comes off second best. And yes, he does have Cull the Meek to get those hit points back. It is maxed out as well at level 5. But it's just not enough to keep him in lane and not enough to keep him up on the farm.
Yeah, that is surprising. That kind of signals to me a really, you know, big outplaying by Jax thus far. Especially considering Jax has been ganked twice, has died twice, and is up so much in farm. Yeah, generally you'll see the lane snowballing the other way, but you're just really superior CSing, especially against Renekton, who has kind of easy farming in the sense that they can, you know, they can use their skills to clear out waves, especially with Q. You can E through and Q and, you know, pick up the ranged minions at least, and once you get a couple levels more, you can just pick up all 6 minions at once. But it does look like they're probably going to go for a gank here, probably waiting for Slice and Dice to be used. Unfortunately, nothing going to become of that gank, as Slice and Dice was used essentially defensively.
Something else needs to be pointed out. I got my numbers wrong. It's 1 green for Wild Growth and Magic the Gathering, but it gives you a +3/+3. I got my numbers backwards. It's been a while since I've played Magic the Gathering, but, you know, my bad chat. And it's Giant Growth as well. But anyways, back to League of Legends. 2,000 gold advantage at the 13-minute mark. It's a fairly sizable number. But 1,000 gold of that is compliments of the dragon, and of course having first blood bonus and the bonus kill, plus the farm, that is where it's coming from. Lee Sin at the moment, double Doran's, boots, cloth armor, almost finished his phage. And he's running with oracles.
Yeah, and now they have the oracles and 4K does not, so really unfortunate. It's only a 1 kill difference, but a 2,000 gold difference. Jax, once again, putting a lot of pressure on top. Doesn't look like the blue buff is going to be challenged. No, Anivia is going to get that. That's one thing that generally, if you're ahead, you really want to challenge Anivia's blue buff, because without it, she doesn't get that free farm. And she, of course, has Tear Goddess and Chalice of Harmony, so she's getting a lot of mana regen in addition to that blue buff, but that is what Anivia needs. Looks like there's going to be a gank bottom, although Blitzcrank is already at half life, has been roaming for a long time, and has actually left Samwise down bottom to farm on his own. But he's been doing a stellar job. Urgot and Sorokin really just didn't pick a point to really go aggressive.
Rocket Crab does land, though, immediately into the Power Fist, followed up by the Static Charge, but now with the Flash and the Heal, does mean that Storg can keep Awesome Fusion alive. So Urgot gets out of that one. Now in the top lane, Jax is the one that's in trouble. Does take a stun to the back. Ultimate comes out from Baron Panda. Dominus is now going to be ticking away the damage per 5. Baron Panda takes so much damage from the turret. And even 2v1, Jax still manages to pick up a kill. Compliments of all that damage from the turret.
Yeah, I was a little confused bottom lane, because it looked like that was a really great gank opportunity. But even as it was, Blitzcrank landed the Great Pull, but didn't throw out the Ignite. And therefore, of course, the heals were that much more effective. Top lane, Lulu defending that turret relatively well, doing quite a bit of damage to Anivia, who's probably just going to back off at this point. Both of the APs made their way up top a little bit after the action.
The thing that was interesting about that as well, every single heal was used bar for the summoner spell. So Wish went out, Astral Blessing went out, so even the Awesome Fusion took a lot of damage. Not being able to silence Soraka or not being able to hold Soraka in place meant that she could keep Awesome Fusion alive. And I definitely think they need to turn their attention to Soraka, because she's going to go down to that burst a whole lot quicker than Urgot is with that Terra Capacitor up.
Right, I mean, he has Terra Capacitor, he has also, you know, all the components for a Frozen Heart now. Has not built it, of course, but has the components, will be building that very soon. So it looks like we're going to see the very, very tanky-style Urgot. But I wonder if we're going to see, you know, full tank. Is he going to go GA next, or is he going to go into a Last Whisper? I am very intrigued to see that. But how well is it really going to work if you're not building damage on Urgot and your Renekton really isn't doing very much damage? It's kind of being shut down by that Jax top lane.
Yeah, they're not going to be able to transition into the team fight stages, because yes, they'll have survivability, but that means nothing if you're not going to kill somebody. If you survive longer, you need to be able to deal enough damage to actually pick up some kills. And right now, Mondo, Renekton, and Urgot not looking like they're hurting too much. Every single time Sweagol jumps onto Baron Panda, the stun comes out from Baron Panda, followed up by a dive backwards. We do see a kill happening on the bottom lane. Wish actually took place as well, so we'll rewind this one in just a second. It's a hyperkinetic position reverser, swaps that Blitzcrank backwards. The Rocket Grab pulls a creep instead of Awesome Fusion. Power Fist does go up. One more Star Call is going to be enough from Stork to pick up the kill. Now they've turned their attention. Cypher Lynette is trying to take out Awesome Fusion, but the Battle Cost and Terra Capacitor are so powerful.
Oh man, I was like, oh, the heal's not going to be off in time, but that Terra Capacitor came up and just that little bit of life. So essentially, kind of a misplay on the part of AAA there. Really, really bad in a couple of areas. The hook obviously missed. That was a lot of damage missed out, especially since, is Lynette still leveling up that hook? Yeah, actually has four levels on that hook.
I'm keeping an eye now on the kill that happened in the mid lane. Lee Sin and Lulu just completely dived that middle lane and tore Anivia apart.
Right, and even, you know, chased her down through the flash. Really good show with the wild growth there of Lulu to make sure she got knocked up and was out of range enough of the turret that Lee Sin could just keep on beating on her in relative safety and not worry about losing his Oracle. But yeah, bottom lane, they kept on fighting Urgot even after his ultimate, but his ultimate has, man, it gives him, what, 105 armor and magic resist for 3 seconds. That is huge. There's like no point in attacking him for the next 3 seconds. But yet they did keep on attacking him. Did not go incredibly well. We might see a little bit of a payback bottom lane. Nope. A lot of people coming in after that Graves.
But, I just watched that team fight in slow mo. Urgot went down to 3 hit points, activated Terra Capacitor, took a Power Fist to the face, a couple more hits, and then went down to 6 hit points. So during the course of one fight, was on single digits for the better part of 10 seconds and still did not die. So wow, what a huge play from Awesome Fusion. All of that armor and magic resist and, you know, the benefit from the position reverser, as well as the bonus armor from Astral Blessing, really shining through.
And his passive, because at one point I was like, why is he turning around to hit Blitzcrank? And I was like, oh, he probably wants to get his passive on him so Blitzcrank does a little bit less damage. At the same time, like, obviously, Lynette better Blitzcrank than I'll ever be, but might be a little bit, you know, wanting to have leveled up that Power Fist.
So we see now we have another huge engagement at the minute. I need to go slow down the speed at the moment. Dr. Mundo's the first one to fall now. The next one's going to be Lulu. She did pop that Wild Growth on herself, but it's not going to do a huge amount to save her life. And now turn their attention onto Urgot. He's the next one to fall. Jackson Leeson forced out of the fight. Lynette is running back. He does have Power Fist available. Is he going to pull somebody in? He's going to need to throw that up. The Crag lands as well as the Power Fist into the air. Now Baron Panda takes some damage, but the Glacial Storm does finish Jax off in the background. So a 2-for-2 trade, jungler and AD carry for top lane and AP mid. But wow, what a rocket grab and Power Fist from Blitzcrank.
Yeah, although the next Power Fist and rocket grab really backfired, as did that one. So he's had two Power Fists or rocket grabs in a row that actually really backfired and got people killed. In the first instance, obviously, they got Jax killed with the Power Fist. Really thought they were going to kill Renekton, didn't. And then the second one gets both himself and Graves killed. And I think, did that kill on Renekton just go to the tower? So it was essentially, man, 3-for-0. After the initial fight that was in AAA's favor, it then goes 3-0 in favor of 4K there.
And it does need to point something out. Look at the mids. 3-1-2 on Anivia, 3-1-4 on Lulu. So both of the AP mids are picking up kills and you know, getting a pretty good advantage. But look at the CS on Lulu. Lyumi is sitting 50 creep kills ahead of Anivia at the 20-minute mark.
Right, and even though they lost that fight, now they've picked up Dragon. So they're 2 kills down, but they are up in gold thanks to that Dragon. I was kind of wondering if the Dragon was going to be attempted by Anivia and Soraka, but between the two of them, they have very little consistent damage. Could run out of mana. Probably didn't want to be in position there where it would take them so long to kill it that AAA would get back up and actually steal it and kill them. So probably a good idea on their part not to try that Dragon, but the result is, you know, despite the fact that AAA got kind of smoked in that fight, they are still up in gold, and you know, obviously Lulu doing a really good job of farming. But I will say, you know, obviously at the beginning of that fight, AAA looked like they had the advantage, but as the fight kind of wore on, you know, if Mundo survives a little bit longer, then that fight goes completely differently. And yeah, the consistent damage from AAA could be a problem. It doesn't seem like they're really doing enough to kill them. And one thing we don't see on either team is an Aegis yet. I'm always like, yeah, first team with an Aegis wins. We do see a Frozen Heart on Urgot, so he does have that aura. And we do see an Abyssal Scepter on Lulu. So an aura on either side of the teams. But,
Hyperkinetic position reverser. That pulls Soez all the way backwards. He flashes away immediately. And the Glacial Wall,
this is barely.
So close. The wall also almost locked Leeson in, but he did manage to get away at that very last second.
Shoo. Yeah, so there's a lot of potential initiation, although 4K just kind of used their whole bag of tricks for initiating.
I wonder, what I would like to see now from the side of 4K is committing to a team fight because they know they can survive the damage. They've shown it once or twice already, and as long as they can keep Anivia in the back line, she's the one that really tore everybody apart. You know, everybody else dropped the health low, and Yamato Potato landed a couple of good Flash Frosts. He had a pretty good wall. What is that? It's Crystallize, I think it's called. A pretty good wall. Once Urgot had actually pulled Yamato Potato, you know, towards him, he then knew exactly how to direct Graves' actions and land additional damage. So I like what Yamato Potato is doing at the moment, and now we're going to have to see whether or not Lynette's going to be able to land a hook just out of range. Once again, a Flash Frost lands, but 4K just not close enough to convert it.
And it looked like AAA setting up for that Baron. They do have the Oracle advantage, which is pretty huge at this point in the game. You know, 22 minutes, anywhere around this period of time is when everyone really starts focusing on Baron, and having that Oracle to make sure you have the map awareness advantage is really, really big. Especially if you have a Blitzcrank, you have an Oracle, they don't have an Oracle, you put down the wards, they don't have any wards, you can certainly catch them out of position. So we'll see how that comes. Jax did just pick up his Trinity Force, so he is now a very strong beast. There's only 20 CS ahead of Renekton. Renekton actually started catching up. Despite the fact that he was losing battles, losing fights really bad, he was able to catch up on the farm. And I think Jax only caught up you know, recently because Renekton was hanging out middle for a while there. So essentially, even throughout the laning phase there. That being said, Jax certainly doing more damage than Renekton in these teamfights.
Part of that as well had to do with the fact that Jax lost his tower fairly early on and immediately started roaming. You know, they were pushing for Dragon together. He was there when they were picking up the first and the second Dragon. So it allowed Renekton a little bit of time just to get some breathing room, just to pick up a couple of uncontested creep kills. And it's helped. I mean, he's finished his Hectoring set. He's got a Phage up. He's also got a Chain Vest. So he's starting to look a little bit more tanky. He's starting to be able to deal a little bit more damage. Mundo's gone down in both fights. I think he's lost two Oracles. He lost one very early on. And in that previous team fight where he went down, I'm fairly confident he was wearing another Oracle's Elixir.
Yeah, he was. Yeah, he was definitely wearing an Oracle. Definitely did lose it. And it's kind of amusing, too. This often happens. I don't know if there was an argument or, you know, oh, shoot, that
huge rocket grab. The jump comes out, counter-attack locked, and look at the height that Yamato Potato gets. The knock-up from Wild Grab in conjunction with a Power Fist, he gets uppercutted like it's Mortal Kombat.
That birdie can fly, I tell you what.
Nice.
People always complain that she's too slow, but she was going fast, just in an upwards direction there. Nice pull, nice Wild Growth.
Oh.
Everything really worked out perfectly there. And they're 4,000 gold in the lead, despite the fact that they're a kill down. They really kind of have control here. And as I was saying before that fight broke out, you know, Mundo was like, hey, I've bought two Oracles. How about you buy some, Miss Support Lady? So Soraka does have the Oracles now. Soraka also rushing towards Reverie. No one is going to pick up an Aegis anytime soon. No one really has components. And I really think that would be huge because that would just make their whole team a little bit more tanky for 4K. And likewise, no Aegis on the other side, but Blitzcrank does have a Zeke's Herald, which will give his team a little bit extra damage. Lee Sin, Jax, and Graves all going to benefit from that pretty substantially. And also a thing to consider is Lulu's passive makes her auto attacks do a little bit of damage as well, so she'll be, you know, on occasion auto attacking and benefiting from that Zeke's Herald.
I'm a big fan of that. What I also like seeing Yamato Potato sitting with a Chalice of Harmony, Athene's Unholy Grail, come on, we'll be seeing it shortly enough. I'm a fanboy, I'm not gonna lie, I like the item.
I mean, I like it too. I don't know that that's what they'll be building towards. You know what I really like that a lot of other people do not like? Archangel Staff. It gives you really good AP for the price. Of course, it gives you no survivability, and I think that's why people don't like it. But the other thing it gives is actually a lot of mana regeneration. For instance, Tear Goddess only gives 7 mana regen per 5. Archangel Staff, when completed, actually gives 25 mana regen per 5.
That's a huge amount. For everybody that's sitting on stream at the minute, we've set the viewer record for today's stream. This is, of course, the Dreamhack qualifying qualifiers. What that means is the top two teams from EU West today and the top two teams from Nordic and East today will be qualifying for Sunday's event, and Sunday's the one that matters. Sunday's the one that is going to get you a spot in the Dreamhack final. We see right
now. Oh my goodness, this is a fast Baron. It's because of that Zeke's, baby. That Zeke's making him do it real fast. They are going to finish it. They do finish it. Yeah, at this point, you know, 10 seconds is all you really need. Jax, Wild Growth, they're kind of running away here, but they have Baron and they're all at full life. Why not just fight?
Jax has just recommitted to the fight. He lands a Leap Strike. The first one to go down is Renekton, followed quickly by Urgot. Finally, Jax gets blown up. He was the first focus from Against All Authority, but trading 1 for 3 and managing to grab Baron in the background. That's more than a fair trade. Now they're going to be pushing forward. Storr just gets completely blown up. 2 auto attacks and a Glitter Lance is all that's needed. Lynette is now moving forward. Can he land the Rocket Grab? 1 second. It is available. He's going to be moving Rocket Grab and it missiles. He predicts the wrong direction. He uses the overdrive. He's going to be trying to get forward. Silence comes out. Now Lynette's on the way backwards. He doesn't have that mana shield. And Yamato Potato manages to survive.
That was so close, he could have just power fisted at that point. He was like almost standing right next to him. He says, this game is so buggy. I probably did try to auto attack and for whatever reason didn't go through. One thing with Blitz is he has kind of a weird animation and doesn't attack very fast, especially if overdrive isn't up. So maybe he thought he auto attacked and then was going for the hook, just for that extra burst damage. But alas, no sale on the kill for Nivea. But obviously the fight incredibly in favor of AAA. They also pick up that dragon, I believe. And now they are, you know, in the driver's seat, almost 8,000 gold in the lead. And really, yeah, there's nothing that 4K can do. I mean, nothing that 4K really has in mind for this sort of disadvantage. I think one big portion of their style is that you have to stay close enough so that none of your teammates are instantly bursted down. But the interesting thing about that is, like, Baron was taken. Obviously, no one was using their ultimates to kill Baron, but then they get caught by the enemy team and they just start running away. And it took Jax, you know, it seemed like a good, like, 3-4 seconds to be like, okay, I'm actually going to fight this. Whereas had he turned around and fought earlier, it probably would have been, you know, a cleaner 5-0 ace.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. I do think they should have played a little bit more aggressive. The only champion that was a bit low was Lee Sin, and he could have just waited a little bit to commit to the fight. Now we're going to see, is a rocket grab going to land? A brilliant flash frost stops Lynette in his tracks. Just before this fight comes up really quickly, 309 ability power for Yamato Potato on Anivia. Lulu, on the other hand, 639. That is a massive difference.
Oh man, well, I always make fun of, you know, people playing AP Lulu because her AP ratios are so terrible. It's like a combined, what, 1.0 or maybe a 1.1 now. They just keep on getting nerfed because she's so powerful for early game, but it doesn't matter when you have 639 AP and a DFG and Abyssal. Well, it doesn't matter if your AP ratios aren't stellar, you're just going to beat people down very, very quickly.
Now, taking a look at that, the Rocket Grab does jump in, but they don't really want to focus Renekton. And look at the damage going on to Sweagol. The knockup comes up from the Wild Growth. Wish has now been used as well. Dragon's Rage forces that Knucklehead back. It's pretty much a counter-initiation, because without being able to stick to the team, they're not going to be able to commit. But Jax took so much damage there. And the burst from 4K is very, very good.
It really did take a ton of damage. And I think this is the second time in this game we saw Trinity Force first. Of course, is being followed by a Buildwater Cutlass. So same exact build as we saw in our previous game. I mean, had AAA not had Baron there, I think that would have been like a counter engage that would have went incredibly in 4K's favor. But since they did have Baron, obviously 4K was not going to follow that up, because their sustained fight, as we've talked about all game long, is, you know, superior. And now that AAA is kind of split up, they're going to take some gold back, make sure they take a turret, which is a great idea. Even though you're behind, it doesn't mean opportunities are not presenting themselves. And there they saw an opportunity where Jax's top lane still a half life. Hey, we can just push down this middle turret pretty easy here.
I like the way Nivia's building as well. Got the death cap, got the components. Now look at Lynette, completely caught out. It's focused. Wild Growth flashes over the wall. Are they going to chase him down? That's the real question. Acid Hunt is still landing. And wow, Lynette manages to get away. Yeah, the movement speed as well as that Wild Growth, just enough to keep him in the game. We'll keep him moving.
Whimsy and Overdrive makes it for a very fast robot there. Oh, I thought they were going to lose out their blue buff, but blue buff's not up, so no one's going to lose out on that. But yeah, I mean, AAA playing aggressively, they have Baron, they have the advantage, they have a huge gold lead, but they don't have the gold lead advantage where they can take on a 4v5.
Now, there was also Lynette playing very, very aggressively. He's sitting with Boots and Mobility. He's also got the Overdrive ability, so when he pops that, he is moving at incredible speed, and he needs to let the rest of his team move up. He cannot commit 1v5, and you've seen why. He gets focused and blown up very, very quickly. I just hovered over Liumi just very, very quickly. And that ultimate, that Wild Growth, Overgrowth, Multiple Growth, whatever it's called, rewards 970 bonus health. It provides the knockup and a 60% movement debuff for 7 seconds. That's huge stats at this stage in the game.
That is huge. I don't get too excited, but your favorite item was just purchased.
Yes, that's what I like to see. So, Anivia now, 342 ability power. Mana regen is going to be very, very high. Compliments of Athene's Holy Grail. I want to see, how is the tier looking? Tier is currently sitting 792. That's almost maxed. If that gets completed to an Archangel's, the bonus mana from that, in conjunction with the Death Cap, in conjunction with Unholies, that's going to be a 600-odd AP Anivia, and that's going to be hitting like a freight train.
Right, and she will certainly be hitting harder than Lulu, in my estimation.
And look at that, the rocket grab into Power Fist. Goodbye, Knucklehead. It was nice knowing you.
Yeah, at the same time, well, they're going to push this turret down because they feel very confident. Generally, pushing against Anivia is very hard. As we saw, even though they pushed that turret down, they didn't actually have creep support. Oh my goodness, and Lynette just charging in through the turret, taking tower shots, still taking tower shots, I think. Almost gets caught in by that wall.
But they pick up the tower for free. I mean, you don't mind taking a bit of damage to fall back. Now they've got a naked inhibitor. I mean, any time against All Authority 1, any one of the champions can move in. Jax, Graves, or Lee Sin, they tear inhibitors and towers apart.
Indeed, yeah. Certainly, you have to be aware of that. Baron coming up soon. So, I mean, there could kind of be like a devil's choice play wherein they could go, they could fake for Baron and try to go for that inhibitor. They kind of have more options open to them now than do SK. It looks like Urgot building a Hex Drinker. Looks like he is going to build into Maw Malmortius, which is kind of unusual. I don't see that too often on him, but it is a tanky DPS item, which does kind of fit the role that Urgot is trying to fill here. Meanwhile, we see a Spirit Visage on Mundo and another Kindle Gem being picked up by Soraka. I don't know necessarily what that is going to go into, but it is certainly not going to go into an Aegis, which has me very, very sad that there's no Aegises in this game unless my eyes are deceiving me.
That Kindle Gem could be upgraded. What's not the Locket of the Iron Solaria? Possibly?
Does that need a Kindle Gem? I thought it did not.
I can't recall. I've never bought one, ever. 3,000 odd games of League of Legends played and I've never bought a single one, so I'm not certain.
Fair, it's new, so it's not surprising. But that being said, like, I really advocate against it because it's not very gold efficient.
Look at this at the moment. Now they are going to decide who they're going to commit. They've managed to catch Soraka. That's a brilliant, absolutely amazing rocket grab, but look at the background now. Jax and Blitzcrank immediately force backwards. They cannot take the damage. The first kill is Urgot, and Dr. Mundo still in and amongst the thick of it. He's the next one to fall down, and they just cannot. They don't have that attack damage carry to finish off the low health champions. Lulu picks up a double kill. Lulu picks up a triple kill. Graves closes it out, and that's a team ace.
Shoo. Yeah.
Wow.
That actually looked like it was going relatively well for 4K in the sense that, you know, no one died initially. Soraka got out, used her ultimate, survived, but then Urgot kind of overextended without team support. And yeah, wow. Everyone just survived for a AAA too, so they kind of outlasted. And then, of course, you know, Graves on your team at the end of a fight with that Zeke's Herald just doing a lot of damage, not to mention, of course, Jax as well. So the damage did outlast the sustained tank in this battle.
And look at the focus, though. I mean, you got four champions at below a third life. If 4K had maybe just focused or dedicated to one particular champion a little bit more effectively, they may have been able to pull that off. But nevertheless, against all authority, pick up the win. They advance to the next round, and 4Kings, their hopes of attending DreamHack have now been squashed.
Oh, that is unfortunate for them. They did play a good game. That was very close most of the way throughout. All the team fights were really, really close until that last one. I mean, it was a 5-0. But, I mean, it could have gone the other way, you know, just in a split second.
Right, so we are going to be organizing the next game, guys. I can see the admins have already started chatting to me on Skype. It's going to be just a few seconds. In the interim, show some support, show some love. Jump on to facebook.com/GG Chronicle. You can follow Sote and the rest of the GG Chronicle streamers and Portal and whatnot. Throw them some love, get their numbers up a little bit. And if you're having some fun with me, you can follow me.